welcome to you all. My name is Andrew Chung, and this is Behind the Music. And this is ahead of our concert, A Question of Balance, which will be performed on November 19th, live from Metropolitan United. Today, I've got with me Graham Mackenzie, who is our principal oboe. Hey, Graham.
Oh, great to be here.
And the two works on this program, we've got Mozart's incredible Gran Partita, and Graham and I are going to talk about that a little bit. And then we've got the Stravinsky Octet, and our conductor for this concert, our very own Scott Harrison, will be joining me in a moment for that. So Graham, let's leap right in. So as I understand it, the Gran Partita, it's a serenade. So it's this 10th serenade composed for winds. And oftentimes serenades, I think, were party pieces. So in many cases, they were composed for a certain occasion, and then they were lost to history. And, you know, the music doesn't exist anymore. In Mozart's case, it was such a tremendous piece, and it is a staple of the repertoire, probably largely because it's totally gorgeous, and I think wind players really love it. So what are the differences between serenades such as this and the symphonies maybe that we know better of Mozart's?
Well, I think what it comes down to in a lot of ways is what they were written for, what purpose they were written for. You know, in this time in history, aristocrats were still employing musicians most of the time. That was so the way that musicians were employed. That's the way music was performed, was at court in their residences. But toward the end of the century, like toward the 1800s, we start to see more and more and more the rise of some degree of middle class anyway, and more concerts, instrumental concerts in concert halls. This is a huge change in the classical era, this addition of the concert in the concert hall that anyone can buy a ticket to, anyone who had money, but that's another point. Anyway, so if you're going to see a symphony in a hall, you would be sitting down to hear that orchestra as we do today, to hear that symphony. And that is what you do. You listen silently to the music. That is the main event. Now, these serenades, as you said, they were for occasions, parties, weddings, even military functions in some cases. There were a wide variety of things it was used for, but the point was that it was background music. Mm-hmm. And so the symphonies of Mozart and composers of this time, they tend to be more, I'd say, serious. They're a bit more complex. They're more in-depth, because the idea is that the listener is listening intently and focusing on that specific piece. Hmm. And in the case of the background music, the serenades, well, this was to be entertainment primarily. It was something to add to an event, but it's not the main event. And like background music in an elevator, you know, Muzak, they're not playing the most complex, intricate, demanding music to listen to. It's typically something meant to be pleasant, help people, put people in a good mood, you know, just make the ambiance nice. So in that sense, that to me is the biggest difference between the two. And it's just reflective of why they were composed, you know, what the events were.
And it's 50 minutes in length, which is pretty long. Like in some cases, that's, you know, double the length of a symphony. Maybe it was that he was told, hey, I've got a party. We need some music. It's going to be an hour long party. What you got? He's like, okay, well, I'll put a few repeats in and, you know, two minuets and this and that and the other. So this particular piece has seven movements, right? Typical symphony has four movements. And the first movement's gorgeous, nice, slow introduction. That's kind of familiar turf and sonata form, right? A typical first movement symphonic device.
Yeah.
No surprises there. It's strange having the two minuets, right? And slow movement.
Yeah, and it's neat how he pairs them. Like, you start with this long movement sonata form, which is really similar to a symphony in that sense. But then the second and third movement and the fourth and fifth movements are these pairs. It's a minuet and trio, or in this case, two trios, which is unusual, but the minuet dance followed by a slow movement. So you have minuet, slow movement, followed by the last two movements of theme and variation and the finale. But I think that's really interesting how he pairs them like that. It provides this kind of structure within a structure to have a bit of repetition, which is what so often form and structure are repetition to make the music feel cohesive and like it makes sense. Mm-hmm. And we have this kind of, you know, we have these forms even within the larger form, because it's just, you know, it's just so long. But yeah, it's very
danced to. I like, would it have been danced to, these minuets? I actually don't know. Do you know?
Not typically. As far as I know, you know, these were written for a lot of occasions, as I say, you know, before, especially dinners, right? Dinners were a big one, some kind of grand dinner, some grand occasion, weddings, even military events. But I've never seen a reference to these particular pieces, as in serenades, being written to be danced to. No. Mm-hmm. Certainly in the Baroque era, of course, this would have been, the music would have been more typically danced to. But the thing is, dance, of course, was still very popular at this time. And these forms of dance, like the minuet and the trio, the idea is that especially the aristocratic audience listening to this would have danced minuets and trios. Like that was the most common possible form of dance. So they may not have been dancing to it, but it would have elicited the feeling of motion of dance. And also just that they would have been able to understand immediately, okay, this feels like a dance. Here's the form. There's the minuet, and we can expect the trio. And now here's the minuet. But then of course, oh wait, there's another trio. That's different, yeah. Right? So he's giving both familiarity and some variety, subverting expectations.
Yes, they're probably dancing in their minds, no doubt.
Yeah, maybe tapping their toes as they, you know, eat their fancy meal, whatever.
Sure, for sure. So, you know, as a string player, I look to his string quartets. You know, they're marvelous, marvelous pieces. Symphonies, operas that I would participate in. And it's incredible string writing. So, and I think to myself, okay, what makes it satisfying? I think there's these gorgeous melodic lines. It's just so well crafted. No one player has filler, right? And I'm just wondering, because I've heard from many corners that his wind writing reigns supreme. It's you know, where he really excelled, and wind players just love playing Mozart. So what's your take on it? You know, what is so special about Mozart's wind writing?
You know, when I think about this question, it's a combination of intangible and tangible things. It reminds me of, like, why do I love eating dark chocolate? Why is it so good? Why is it so delicious? And I can point to all kinds of things, but in the end, it's hard to articulate. There's a certain magic in it that comes from the fact that Mozart was such an incredible melodist, and we see this in his operas in particular, right? Just so many operas with so many famous melodies that are still so so renowned today. And I'm not sure why his wind writing is so particularly special, because of course his string writing, as you know, is special for a lot of the same reasons, the incredible melodies, and that just sound like they could be an aria in any opera.
It's like the middle parts get engaged somehow, so that everyone just has a smile on their face. It's just feel good stuff to play, because it's, I don't know, it's the strangest thing, isn't it?
Well, it is. And it's, you know what it is? I honestly, to me, it really comes back down to the title of this concert. Honestly, when I think, if I really have to try to put my finger on it, why the melodic writing is so good, it's balance. Mm-hmm. It is balance. There's enough repetition that you get a sense of familiarity and continuity. There's enough subtle variety that you get some intrigue and some interest. There's a lot of variety in character, but not so much that it feels overdone, that it feels in your face or slapstick, but there's not so little that it feels like, oh, I kind of see what he's doing, but it doesn't really go all the way. Right through the melody, even without words, you can always feel, you know, I do this with my students all the time. I say, okay, so what would be happening in opera if this was the melody that someone's singing? And they can always immediately go, oh, well, they'd be singing about this. They'd be singing about this. This is the story. This is what they're talking about. Mm-hmm. That's not the same for every composer. So these melodies are so evocative, and they're so well balanced, even in terms of things like in the Gran Partita, there are some places where we have very large leaps, even sometimes an octave and a half, which is very unusual for wind writing around this time. Mm-hmm. But then he offsets it with some much smaller intervals so that it doesn't sound too disjunct, but it also doesn't sound too narrow in its breadth. So it's so perfectly balanced. And, you know, ultimately, it's also, there's no filler. It, like you were saying, there's just no filler. Every single note you play in every single part, second violin, second oboe, second basset horn, doesn't matter. It's all fantastic. And you always feel like it contributes towards the whole. And there are very few composers, in my opinion, Brahms is one of them, who is a master of this as well. You know, like the, no matter what play, what part you play in a Brahms symphony, it's magical. Mm-hmm. And again, Mozart is the same way to me.
I love it. I love it. Now the serenade has some interesting scoring. So 8 woodwinds, 4 horns and a double bass. The 8 woodwinds, what do we got again?
Okay, we have 2 oboes, 2 clarinets. In this case, we have 2 basset horns and 2 bassoons.
Mm-hmm. And the basset horn is, it's like a large clarinet, longer clarinet.
Yeah, it's sort of, it's kind of an in-between clarinet. It's not as low as a bass clarinet, but it's not as high as the normal clarinets. I mean, basset literally means small bass. Right. The reason it's called a horn was because originally it was curved like a horn was, but then it became straight later. Interestingly enough, the instrument never gained much traction outside of Mozart's writing, which is odd because so much of what Mozart did set the stage for what came later. Mm-hmm. Everyone wanted to imitate Mozart in so many ways, but the use of the basset horn really didn't catch on. It was pretty much out of use completely by 1850. Strauss used it in his opera Elektra, or in the early 20th century. I think it was 1905, but that's kind of it.
Right.
So it's really very unusual, absolutely.
And in our performance, it's not like we're bringing on a basset horn revival. We're electing. Someone made the decision somewhere along the way that it's kind of hard to find a good functional pair of basset horns. Yeah. Like, we know that National Arts Center Orchestra, they have a couple. Western University has a couple. But, you know, as to what state of repair they're in at any given time, and whether the players who you're engaging, clarinet players, want to take on that challenge of learning how to play the thing, you know, we just put our Mozart cap on for a moment, and we're just like, what would Mozart do in this situation? This is a guy who would, he would write a wind sextet, and all of a sudden he's like, oh, but this guy really likes oboes, the wealthy patron who's trying to get work from him. I'll just add in 2 oboe parts, you know, and he just does it. So we're like, okay, we have a workaround where we can perform this piece with 4 clarinets, and none would be the wiser. Not many people would be the wiser. So that's the route we're going. No apologies, I think. So tell me a little bit more about the music. So in terms of the 13 players on stage, are they divided into teams somewhat?
You know, they're... And not specifically. I think one of the great things about this piece, actually, and one of the ways that he doesn't create balance problems, since he has 4 horns, bear in mind, right, but no more oboes or clarinets than he normally does, and these two basset horns or clarinets in our case, he uses a lot of different combinations of instruments in order to create different textures and different colors, but he rarely uses everybody at the same time. So what this means is that, and he doesn't use specific teams a lot, and this means that the texture is varied, but not super dense, so balance is okay. Now, there are a few things that are pretty consistent. The first clarinet and the first oboe have a ton of melody. I mean, they are the prima donnas of this piece. I mean, we are singing back and forth the entire piece, all over the place. So that's a very common team, as it were. We're sort of the melody team. But you also see clarinet, bassoon, and horn. That combination is particularly clarinet and bassoon. Mm-hmm. But also, again, clarinet, bassoon, and horn, really, as a trio, that combination is very common, especially in the trios. Mm-hmm. In many classical-type trios, that combination, it just gives a different color. And even in symphonies, we see that combination quite a bit, because the timbres blend really well, register, it works really well. So we do see that as well in this piece. But no, I wouldn't say they're sort of specific teams. You know, we don't have any Maple Leafs versus Canadians here or anything like that.
But it is interesting, though, that you do point out that not everyone's playing all the time. Otherwise, across 50 minutes, people will be gassed, and no one would want to play the thing. But it's comfortable, and you've got a lot of great tunes to play. So Mozart wrote a lot of oboe music. How does this fit slot into the oboe concerto, the oboe quartet? Is it add something, or is it just feels like Mozart, or how would you describe that?
Well, to me, what it is, so in the Mozart Oboe Quartet, which I argue is one of his finest pieces, period, that and the piano quintet that we did last year, thank you, that was fabulous. The Mozart Oboe Quartet is an incredible work for all the reasons we talked about before. It seems operatic, the way it's balanced, the way every part is completely meaningful at all times. But it's on such a smaller scale, right? Three strings, which all are similar timbrally, more similar than the different wind instruments. That's all I mean by that. No disrespect here. And then the concerto, of course, it's a very different role because you have the oboe soloist and then you have the orchestra. And so the orchestra takes on a very different role. And yes, it's always an interaction between soloist and orchestra, but it's not the same feeling of chamber music that we get in the oboe quartet, for example. So what the Gran Partita is for me, it is a true combination of, it does feel kind of like a concerto a lot of the time. It's just, I mean, there's so much oboe melody, and even when it's not, it's still, the melody is still very important. So there's a huge amount of melodic soloistic material all the way through. So you have that responsibility. It's chamber music, which I love. I love, changing roles and suddenly having to be a chameleon and fit within the clarinet sound or the horn sound. It's one of my favorite parts of the job, honestly. I absolutely love that. It's so varied and it's so rewarding to be part of that, and not just the melody all the time, but lastly, it's also to me a chance to be part of a larger work of chamber music, which is fantastic. The octets are wonderful with eight players, incredible music. But this, the addition of the two horns, the double bass, the two clarinet parts, it adds so much texture and color and possibilities. And that means that even in this 50-minute piece, it's never boring because there's so much variety. And I think that's harder to accomplish with a smaller chamber group. So it's wonderful on so many levels.
Now, before we go, we've just performed our season opener at Metropolitan United Church, completely renovated stage. What are your thoughts about this? Did you have fun? What does it mean to you to perform in an with a different acoustic? Because it is quite different than playing on the carpet previously. Talk a little bit about that.
Oh, it was incredible. I mean, it was amazing. I just we've always been very grateful and lucky to have Met United as a home base. It's a beautiful venue. The acoustics have always been good. They're warm. They're relatively friendly, but this was very different. The having the floor as a reflective surface allowed so much more resonance and ring in the hall so easily. It felt like we didn't have to push as hard. It felt like we could cheer each other more. It felt like we could play softer and not have it sound a bit dull or dead almost, which we had to, we any hall you have to balance that. But I felt in this acoustic, it was wonderful. People could really get play softly and still project easily. I think that it looks a lot better, of course. I mean, we are one orchestra. I mean, we are one, as the last concert was titled. We truly are, though. We're one group. And I think to be on one plane, it looks more unified, but also feels and sounds more unified. We can hear each other better. We can see each other better through communication. It always felt a little weird being way up and having to kind of look down at the string section. Not hugely, but it does make a difference. So all of those things, I was thrilled with that, and I listened to the recording and I thought, wow, I mean that the it really adds a whole dimension to the sound of the orchestra, a whole new level of energy and excitement and just resonance.
It's like having a new toy to play with, isn't it? And
Yeah.
we get to know more and more the more we perform, and in different configurations, how this space is going to respond. Thanks so much for joining me today, Graham, and I really look forward to hearing this performance.
Of course, my pleasure.
And now we welcome Scott Harrison, who's our trumpet player, but for this performance, he's picking up the baton and he'll be conducting our wind ensemble. Hey, Scott, how are you?
I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Terrific, thank you. So let's talk a little bit about the Stravinsky Octet for wind instruments. So this was composed back in 1922. Just take me back to that time a little bit. What the audience reaction was, what were they expecting?
Well, I think it's safe to say that the initial reaction wasn't positive. But part of what was going on, it's 1922, right? So we've just come out of the First World War. And I think it's safe to say that Europe is reacting to the cataclysm. What just happened? We can't keep going on the way we were before. What did all that romanticism, what did all that emotion get us? And as artists and philosophers in Europe are starting to address that question, they come up with a different idea. Maybe it's no longer appropriate or desirable for an audience to go to a concert performance and be emotionally swept away. Maybe being swept away by emotions is what got us into the First World War in the first place. So maybe going to a concert should be something else. Maybe it should be about instead of sort of a like a it should be an intellectual experience. Maybe it's not an emotive experience. Maybe it's just clean intellectualism, something that's pretty and smart, and we're going to listen to that now. Stravinsky, as it turns out, is one of the major architects of this line of thinking. And that's what we now call neoclassicism. And if you're going to embrace neoclassicism, then of course the best choice is to go back to Mozart, who was its greatest practitioner. So I mean, that's part of the reason why these pieces are joined together in this concert, because they're both celebrations of the classical spirit, but in very different contexts.
Interesting. So when you look at the Mozart, and we were just talking about this with Graham, classical forms are on display. We've got sonata form in the first movement, starts out with a nice slow introduction. The Stravinsky has a slow introduction followed by sonata form. The Stravinsky has a theme and variations, and Mozart also has a theme and variations within the Gran Partita. And then there's just three movements in the Stravinsky, so it ends with a rondo, and again, the Mozart also ends with a rondo. So, what I was wondering was Mozart's audience, I feel like they would have known the forms. They would have heard the innovation as it was unfolding in the concert, for their ears for the very first time. What would Stravinsky's audience also have been tracking those classical forms? It's a surprise for them. Like they were expecting to hear kind of his neo-primitive sort of sound that he was renowned for. And then they come to this concert and it's a completely different experience for them. So I wonder what their audience was feeling at that time.
Well, I think classicism in its most basic form is the idea that the intellect comes first. Of course, it would be an illusion to say that classicism doesn't have emotion. Of course it does. But at the top, the essential belief of classicism is nothing is beautiful unless it makes sense intellectually. And Mozart's audience would have been well educated in how those forms worked, the dance forms. They would have danced the dances they were listening to. They would have gone to the expectation of, yeah, there's a slow introduction and then there's this. Oh, isn't it interesting how he's using this theme here and this is here? And they would have recognized the changes right away. But Stravinsky's audience, I kind of like to imagine the premiere of this piece in like some salon somewhere where there's a sort of, there's a group of people who would recognize, oh, wait a minute, he's referring back to the classical period. But in this context, it's so much more murky. It's almost like a distant reference to it. Stravinsky does all these cute things or clever things where he's signaling to us, yeah, these are the classical signposts that sound a lot like what Mozart would have done. Did you just get the joke? Or did you just get the reference? Oh, and here we go. And here's our primary theme. But now it's in a distorted way that Mozart would have found sort of incomprehensible or very, very murky again. And so, yeah, he kind of goes through these motions of saying, okay, here are these signposts that allude to classical style, but to me, even if the audience doesn't pick it up, and I don't know whether his audience would have got it or not, I like to think that portions of them would have. But even then, it doesn't matter, because he's starting from the starting belief of, well, if I'm making a classical piece or a neoclassical piece, it has to be organized in some sort of intelligent way, guided by the intellect. So I'm going to do that. And even if it's not apparent to the audience, that's still how I'm going to make this successful piece. And I do think that that would have come across to his audience very clearly, that there was some plan going on, even if we can't identify it.
And it helps him probably as a composer to have something to base his ideas around and to organize his information that he's trying to put out there. So, you know, the instrumentation for this piece is an octet. So we got a flute, two clarinets, two bassoons, two trumpets, and three trombones. Do I have that right?
No, it's flute, clarinet, two bassoons, trumpet, trombone, trombone.
Thank you. So I try. Do you think there's a jazz band element? Is he trying at something, or is it really not really the case?
I think the big one is that, I mean, I'm a trumpet player, so I have a certain degree of bias here, I'm happy to acknowledge. But there's no instrument in the orchestra that undergoes a greater physical change from, let's say, 1750 to 1950 than the trumpet. It's the 1950 trumpet is almost unrecognizable by the trumpet that, let's say, Mozart knew. So what ends up happening is, by the early 20th century, trumpet now has all these skills that the rest of the orchestra people have had for a long time. They can play chromatically, they can play very softly, they can play with a lot of agility, there's lots of tonguing techniques. So brass players at the beginning of the 20th century are suddenly joining and becoming equals technically with their orchestral partners. And Stravinsky is one of the great composers that exploits this new skill. Trumpet players, you know, Liszt, Ward, Soldat, Petrushka, Rite of Spring, the trumpet parts are fantastic. And part of that is that he's capitalizing on this new instrument. And it's not the trumpet that, Bruckner or Mahler used that had lots of power. It's not that. He knows that these new instruments have all this delicate technique. So it's perfectly reasonable by his time to put four brass players opposite four wind players and expect that the brass players are going to be able to play soft and with enough agility that combination makes sense.
And with enough balance too,
yeah.
Just that dynamic.
Mm-hmm. And even from the first note of this octet, you can hear it, because he starts with the trumpet, mm-hmm. and it's soft and with a little bit of an accent. And he's the trumpet player, in this case, Sean, he is accompanying the wind players. He's saying it right from the beginning. Trumpet is can do this very, very soft and gently. I'll happily say, as a trumpet player, both trumpet parts are incredibly rewarding, because Stravinsky knows how to write agile, soft music for brass players.
It's good to hear you get so excited about this from a trumpeter's perspective. I love it.
I'm a little jealous. I love conducting. I am going to miss playing the parts. Yes. Got to play it a couple times in my career, both first and second. And I know Mike and Sean are going to have a great time playing these parts. They're fantastic.
Awesome. And now when I hear Stravinsky, I feel like I can identify Stravinsky's sound. Is there any way to put that into a tiny nutshell? Like, what is that sound? Like, harmonically, we've got 1 minute, but try your best.
Okay. So
I'll give you two.
Thank you. So the one thing I love about Stravinsky, there, by the time the 20th century rolls around, the European tradition that comes out of the Middle Ages, you know, very rigid, tone leading, first year music students can tell you the torturous rules. They're all, you know, harmony. They all have very specific rules that Bach becomes the first great practitioner of, Mozart, Brahms, Beethoven, you know, they get stretched out. Finally, it reaches its last great gasp in Mahler and Strauss in the 20th century, but then the system breaks. And what happens in that sort of explosion of new ideas, that emancipation, is that all sorts of ideas that would have previously been unthinkable now become all part of the spectrum of what composers can try. And nobody embraces that better than Stravinsky. But the thing that blows me away about Stravinsky, I love about Stravinsky, is he tries multiple techniques. He tries polytonality, he tries pandiatonism, he tries diatonic layering, you name it. Every technique that's around in the 20th century, he experiments with. And yet somehow they all sound like Stravinsky.
Yeah.
It's amazing. And our audience will recognize the huge scope of which Rite of Spring takes place. Mm-hmm. This is at the complete other end of the spectrum. It's much, shorter melodies, use of forms, diatonic resources, very clear and light music. And yet, four bars in, you're like, oh yeah, that's Stravinsky. It's the same guy, even though he's using a completely different color palette, a completely different set of rules. Rite of Spring is primitivism. It's the subconscious. It's a huge, huge landscape of ideas. The Octet is a very modest, very limited palette, very classical spirit. And yet right away you go, oh yeah, both of those are Stravinsky.
It's that
music
guy.
Students rack their brains about how that is. How I can't think of a composer that has a more varied set of techniques and yet still has it all unified by the same wonderful voice.
Mm. So Scott, why should people come out to A Question of Balance November 19th at Metropolitan United?
Well, I you come to London Symphonia because it's going to be great music played by great musicians. I'm so proud of this orchestra and this series. In this specific case, you're looking at two expert composers at the height of their game, trying to solve the same base or answer the same basic question. I want to write a piece for winds in the classical spirit, but because they're very different time periods, they're very different time periods, and they have different starting positions, they come up with very, very different answers. And yet both are wonderful for their time period and expertly written. I love these pieces.
Awesome. Well, I look forward to hearing them in concert, and this will be live, performed live on stage and live streamed as well from Metropolitan United. And this is on November 19th, Saturday at 7:30. Thanks so much, Scott.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to talk to you.